Dion Win.
Hi everyone, welcome back, maybe welcome for the very first time, and this is the fifth episode of my series So You Want to Get Into, and this is dedicated to the directors of world cinema you may or may not know about, and the best entry points to their films. So far on the channel, we have looked at the works of Claire Denis, Simon Lang, Hong Sang-soo, Olivia Assayas, and today I am dedicating this video to Nagisa Ōshima, one of the finest directors to come from Japan, and really has never had the plaudits that he deserves. There's barely any physical releases of his films outside of Criterion. There are not many books about him, video essays, documentaries, not much. But my God, the impact that he has had on cinema is so important. And today we will be giving that great man the justice he deserves, even on this tiny channel. And the way we're going to do this is we're going to be looking at my first experience with Nagisa Ōshima, then we'll look at his style and subtext, and then I'll be giving you three recommendations as entry points into his films. And those will be his masterpiece or the magnum opus according to Letterboxd. Then we will be looking at my personal favourite from his films, and the third will be The All-Rounder, the film that kind of embodies everything that the director stands for. So enough introducing, let's get talking. My initial experience with Ōshima was in The Realm of the Senses from 1976. I had seen it on the movie channel quite a few times. Then thinking, I'll give it a go at some point, not really knowing the true backbone of what it was about, nor the controversy or anything like that about it. And once I watched it, I thought to myself, wow, okay, this is kind of not the normal Japanese period drama that I'm used to. And watching this film, I found it to be quite a riveting, kind of sexually liberating film that kind of explored the human condition and the experiences of women in the past. And this film follows the story of Sada Abe. Sada Abe is well known for killing her lover and cutting off his genitals and then putting it in her kimono and keeping them safe. And this kind of story has like evoked a different kind of films. Obayashi made a film about Sada a few years later, but within In the Realm of the Senses, what I really enjoyed was the exploration of who Sada was. And while this is a fictitious account of what actually happened, what we see within this film is the expressions and the ideas that Ōshima is bringing to the table, because it breaks the conformities of what sex is. People have sex all the time, it's a very natural part of life, but what culture and society has done is kind of repressed it and made it into quite a seedy and disgusting thing. And with this film, it kind of gives you a bit more emphasis on this kind of natural human element that binds us all together. And once we go through this whole film, we kind of understand more of what Ōshima's about, because what he is trying to do is he is trying to explain that we are all connected through these kind of human elements. And that's what I found so compelling from the get-go with him. And in many ways, this film was shrouded in controversy. And the controversy of penetrative sex within an art house film is, yes, okay, going to raise a few eyebrows. But did you know that actually at Cannes Film Festival, when it debuted, this was probably the most viewed film ever in the festival's history? It actually had over 12 screenings, allegedly, when you normally only have three, maybe two screenings per film. And the interest within this film, because it got banned, it got censored, the film got edited in France, it was never kind of condoned by Japan at all. There is just so much history behind it. It just really just gives you this behemoth kind of sense that Ōshima is a lot bigger than what society kind of deems him to be now. This kind of story goes down in cinematic history and still continues to exist today. Now then, to the style and subtext of Nagisa Ōshima, and the best way to do this is obviously to go backwards to his first film. And in 1959, he released a film called Town of Love and Hope. And while I don't find this to be one of his best films, it really sets kind of the ground and the structure of what his work would be. He plants these seeds of exploring the human condition, of exploring childhood, of exploring socio-political change, of a changing Japan within the film. And this film kind of set a precedence because it's very old-fashioned, that even the way it's kind of displayed and projected, it's very basic, but these kind of ideas that he has kind of evoke itself. And then once we go into Cruel Story of Youth in 1960, his second feature film, and actually the second film I ever saw from him, this one was packed full of youth, of revolution, of change, and this kind of sense of how Western culture kind of started to change Japan, potentially for the worse, potentially for the good, we don't really know. But what Oshima does so well here, he kind of builds that teenage angst that was building in Japan during this period, and showing how Japan was kind of perceiving what was going on, and this kind of culture change between old and young, and how this sense of tradition and identity is maybe kind of not dwindling away, but evolving. And this is the thing about Japanese culture. It's kind of ingrained into everything that we perceive with the country. But what Oshima does here is he says, beyond this kind of facade that we have of Japan is a change in culture, is a change in idealism, and in the change of the minds of the young. And that, for me, is something that I find quite so profound. And then we kind of move on again. In 1960, we see a film called Night and Fog in Japan, which is quite an interesting film because it focuses on the left and the right on the political spectrum, and kind of how the idealisms and disillusionment of the left, thinking of a revolutionary change was going to happen fast, but their decisions and their kind of fast-paced life kind of doesn't work out for them, and just how the right is perceiving them. And what Oshima does so well within this film even is that he just allows you to think a little bit more about political ideas and how you would react to these types of situations. And in many ways, this is kind of the groundbreaking film that really built a bit more. And you go into films like Pleasures of the Flesh in 1965, which is a lot more sexually liberating and something that we're just not used to. Oshima and Sejuan Suzuki were kind of flag bearers for this Japanese new wave that was just showing how Japanese film could be so different. And again, we use the comparisons of Ozu and Kurosawa. They are a lot more institutionalized within Japanese film. But when we look at Suzuki and Oshima, they really built a foundation of filmmaking that have inspired many others like Sion Sono or Takashi Miike. They really just made films that kind of stood out and made something so special. Suzuki will get his own video as time goes by, but we'll go back to Oshima now. And then as we go on, we look at the kind of history and politics that is kind of ingrained into his work. History and politics is something that he's always been fascinated in and has always been a massive part of his existence. And he even went down the road of making documentary films. One in particular that I would like to raise is The Diary of Young Boy from 1965. And this is a video photo essay showing the poverty that was going on in Korea during occupation and how children were suffering through it. And it's a very harrowing kind of realistic attack from Oshima, and he just shows how there is, beyond the high respect that we should have for Japan, it just shows this kind of sense of cruelty. And this cruelty is kind of seen across the world. It's not just within East Asia. We see how different countries battle against each other and how ideologies kind of break what people are about. And I think Diary of Young Boy just really shows how Oshima has such a profound admiration for youth and the sense of how the youth of the world can change how the world is perceived now. And we also see this in a documentary also called The Forgotten Soldier. He just really builds on this fundamentality of, he's not anti-Japanese at all, but he just shows the harsh truths and the realities of what we can do to each other. And this kind of humanistic level and approach is so important, because rapport, human rapport, is important, because we can all be connected. We may be from different parts of the world, but we can be connected through our experiences. And that's what I love about Oshima's films. Narrative isn't always focal in his films. It's more about the development of the character, the way that the camera is stagnant. It doesn't always move sporadically or anything like that, but the impact of what he shows on the frame is a lot more crucial to him. And gazing into the eyes of somebody, or these tight shots of just expression. And I love this sense that we get within it. We see films like The Ceremony, Empire of Passion. We see it in, what else? We've got Death by Hanging. We've got Senses, Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence, Maximum and More Taboo. There is just so many of these films that kind of just show the human condition and what it's about. And what we see within Oshima's whole body of work is this sense of social political change within youth demographics and how the history of Japan is perceived and how his own political views are expressed within the films. And that, for me, is enough to kind of understand that he was so important to filmmaking. And many directors have been influenced by him, but they just don't really talk about him, and it baffles me. If my rant about his style and subtext is anything to be held, you really need to give this man a lot of your time. Right then, to the recommendations, and the first one, of course, is the magnum opus or the masterpiece, and on Letterboxd, currently at the highest ranked of all of Oshima's films, is Death by Hanging from 1968, and it follows the story of a Korean man who is sentenced to death in Japan. And when you hear that title, you think to yourself, ooh, okay, this is actually a lot more shady than I thought it would be, and potentially it's going to be quite a heavy-hitting drama. But what Oshima does with this film is that he sets a lot of symbolism and metaphors for kind of the condemnation of capital punishment and what the Japanese government were doing to other East Asian people. And within this film, it's very amusing, it's satirical, there is a dark comedy element to it. And it's such a profound and harsh reality that Oshima delivers within Death by Hanging. And in many ways, I think this is kind of one of the most politically strong films that he has. And to some people, yes, this may not be his masterpiece. I don't consider it to be his masterpiece, but this is how it's regarded. And I think in many ways, it kind of shows you the Oshima at his kind of most powerful, because at the back end of the 1960s, he had made a lot of films, and this was when he was kind of striking up to resonance, because we have films like Death by Hanging, we have films like Boy, we have films like The Ceremony, we have In the Realm of the Senses. A lot of these films kind of follow from Death by Hanging, and this one was really well regarded, even in Japan. It was one of the best grossing films of the year in 1968, and critics actually applauded what Oshima attempted with it. And that kind of sets what, within an artistic realm, Oshima had. He had the power and he had that influence on people that he was recognized. Right then, my personal favorite film is Boy from 1969, and I actually got to see this film last year during the first lockdown. I was watching two or three films a day, that films I'd never seen before, films I should have seen, and I decided to myself I would watch a few more Oshima films, and Boy was the first one I had watched in a very long time. I hadn't heard much about it, but my fascination with kind of childhood experience through my research for a PhD has kind of like built into this. And what I found in this film was one of the most harrowing stories about family and the sense of family trying to make a living for themselves, even in a impoverished state. And what is so horrible about this film is the parents. The parents are struggling financially and there is no help for them. But the father also struggles from mental health issues and is not regarded to have any help. And this sense of Oshima is trying to say that even the unwell need assistance. But the way that the family make ends meet is through conning people in car accidents and then bribing them for money. And they utilize their children then to further enhance this con. And I found it a horrible existence for a child. Even though this is a fictitious tale, it's based on actual events. And what Oshima does here, he really just strikes home the sense of how childhood can be lost through these very horrible situations and circumstances. And the childhood is forgotten. The sense of survival is more important than being a kid. And there's one scene in particular at the back end of this film. It's a static shot of the little boy in snow. And it's one of the most beautiful scenes I've ever seen in the film. It sticks with me to this day. And it just shows the prowess and the poignancy that Oshima had. Because this human connection can be felt even through a child that wasn't exactly a known actor or anything like that. He just got the best out of his players, and he just built into something so special. Boy is one of my favorite films of all time now, and I really encourage you to watch this film. It is available on Criterion Channel, like most of Oshima's films. Right then, to the all-rounder, the most accessible film that Oshima has made, and I would say is Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence, from 1983. This one stars Takeshi Kitano, David Bowie, Ryuichi Sakamoto. It has everything that you want from Oshima. He looks at history, he looks at the human connection, he looks at political decisions that have kind of changed the way the world perceives Japan. And this kind of West meets East kind of culminates beautifully in this film between these prisoners of war. And that sense of understanding people from a human level. While there are scenes that are absolutely brutal and harsh, and it just shows the true face of war, what Oshima does here is just builds this human connection that we have. And I think Bowie is phenomenal in this film. Takeshi Kitano stands out as hell. But I really love how Sakamoto and Bowie's connection is kind of built within this kind of like homoerotic consensus. And while we were in the 1980s, HIV was quite rife at this point. We see this kind of undertones that don't propel into anything. But what Oshima is here, he's pushing boundaries again. The pushing of boundaries is so important, and everything within this film just shows how we can get along and how we all have gone through similar experiences. And this film is striking. Sakamoto's score in this film, even, I absolutely love the score that he put into this film, and it's honestly one of my favorite Oshima films. There is an Arrow Academy Blu-ray of this film, there's a Criterion, it's on Criterion Channel. It is probably the easiest film to find of all of his work, but I would highly implore anybody to maybe start with this very film. So then, that was my exploration into the world of Nagisa Ōshima. This man could, well, he deserves about 20 hours worth of videos from me, but I think this is a good taster for you to understand what he's about and the films that you should really be checking out. There is so much to dig into him, and like I said, there is about 15 films on the Criterion Channel of his available right now. If you're not too sure how to access the Criterion Channel outside the USA and Canada, drop me a message below. I'll give you a hand sorting it out, but it's very handy. Thank you very much for watching. Like, share, subscribe, do as you please. And as we normally say this channel, Dio, danke, obrigado, merci beaucoup, arigato, danke schön, bitte schön, all the shins, and obviously, never change. Bye.